Hello children, I'm here today to do this wonderful chapter with you, The Ailing Planet, the Green Movement's Role by the very learned Mr. Nani Palkhivala. Before we go into a detail about this chapter, children, this is something which we cannot escape today. The chapter talks about the global warming which is threatening us. This talks about how human beings for centuries have always felt that nature was for their benefit. But today this will not work. Today we need to change our entire thought process. Today we need to have a relationship with the planet. Otherwise, it is needless to say, I'm sure all of you keep hearing about the tsunamis, you keep hearing about the floods and things whereby we can sense, we can feel how nature is infuriated by our insensitivity towards it. So we're going to do this planet, this story about this planet, about the ailing planet, and look at the word which is used, ailing planet. We're talking about the earth, we're talking about our planet, and we're terming it as ailing. It's still not death. So there is a touch of optimism in that, that the planet is ailing. So let's quickly do something about it before it actually dies. And if it dies, obviously it's going to have lethal effects on all our lives. Here we have a lovely photograph of Mr. Palkhivala, and let's see what we can find out about the author. The late Nani Palkhivala was a passionate Democrat, patriot, and above all, a great human being. The Nani A. Palkhivala Memorial Trust was set up in 2004. The main objective of the trust is the promotion of liberal economic thinking for national development and the preservation of India's priceless heritage. About the chapter. The chapter comments on the deteriorating condition of our planet. It speaks of the problems faced by our planet, reasons for its poor condition, and the changing view of the world for the planet. So the chapter I've already spoken about, it's very clearly your title talks about the ailing planet. And children, this chapter was written years back, and ever since, you know, all the figures that are given here, they kind of not only double but maybe triple or go much ahead, because the population has grown so much more. So what Mr. Palkhivala said and wrote at that time, which is a few decades back, obviously, situation is far more dangerous, far more pathetic now. Initiation of the Green Movement is something you're going to read in the chapter, children. It started nearly 25 years ago. World's first nation Green Party was founded in New Zealand in 1972. So it is not just 25 years back, but much more. Since we are reading it much later now, we are reading it in 2016. And the Green Party was founded, and this was a movement where very, very early, years back, decades back, people realized that suddenly we need to preserve the green environment. People could intuitively feel that things would be going wrong. The way human beings have been attacking nature, it was going to have an impact on us. And we know now, we can see there is already an element of chaos. I dread to think what nature is going to do to us with our insensitive attitude towards it if we do live to see it for another 10, 20 years, it's going to be totally in an attacking mood. Green Movement's role, the Green Movement, a term that includes the conservation and green politics, is a diverse scientific, social and political movement for addressing environmental issues. Environmentalists advocate the sustainable management of resources and stewardship of the environment through changes in public policy and individual behavior. So the Green Movement talks about sustainable development and says the policies have to change. We cannot just keep attacking the resources. We cannot keep killing and we cannot be cutting the trees insensitively, attacking the sea animals, attacking the other animals. They are going to be species which will become extinct, and that is going to cause a huge problem to future evolution. So we have to talk about sustainable development, which means that we must be very conscious of how much we take for our sustenance, because we must now awake to a reality that we will be leaving nothing for generations to come. If there are no forest children, there are going to be no animals. Can you imagine children years later will grow up without the pleasure of seeing animals like monkeys or other animals which we have grown up with? So it is very important to realize that our totally attacking and insensitive totally apathy towards the requirements of the environment is going to be very, very destructive for generations to come. Primary focus of the great movement, conservation movement seeks to protect natural areas for sustainable consumption as well as traditional hunting, fishing, trapping, and spiritual use. So the whole drive, the focus of the green movement is not only the tree, the vegetation, but it talks about that we have to be very conscious of our consuming of wildlife or sea life or anything like that. That conservation is very, very important. We already know that we have this threat of the tiger becoming an extinct animal. And there'll be, in years to come, if we don't do something very quick and very fast, we are going to destroy species. And, you know, there are millions of species which are still not known to the human race. Maybe many of them already destroyed with the kind of attack human beings have been making on nature. In its recognition of humanity as a participant in ecosystems, the movement is centered on ecology, health, and human rights. So it talks about that we need to sustain, and what is the human right? The human right is that everyone has a right to have fresh air to breathe, everyone has a right to food, everyone has a right to good health. So these are the human rights, and all this can be totally destroyed if we are not going to do something immediately about trying to stop our total attack and insensitive ways of just extracting things out of nature, out of our Mother Earth, and not thinking even about planting more trees. If we do need to cut trees, let us also start a movement about planting trees. It's high time that each one should plant a tree, because let us leave something nice for the generations to come, for our children who are going to come. We have to look at the environment today with a total different concept. Environment health movement dates at least to progressive era and focuses on urban standards like clean water, efficient sewage handling, and stable population growth. Environmental health could also deal with nutrition, preventive medicine, aging, and other concerns specific to human well-being. Environmental health is also seen as an indicator for the state of the environment, or an early warning system for what may happen to humans. So it is warming. Already it's warning us that this kind of global warming is going to be killing us. We have a higher rate of cancer. We have lethal rays coming to us. We have our environment getting destroyed, and the total climatic zones are getting totally warped, and you're having rains when you shouldn't be having rains. You have places which have never had parched lands, have kind of parched lands all around. So everything is going haywire. This is with an imbalance that has been created with the humans attacking nature and only attacking and doing nothing to rejuvenate it, to sustain it, to give it a new life. Why is the planet damaging. It's damaging so much because of the mankind, because of human beings just taking and refusing to give anything. Mankind is now the number one cause of all the destruction happening on earth, as well as trying to destroy each other on the battlefield. We are the cause of a series of disasters beginning. So we are not only killing on the battlefield, we are also destroying things because we have just become so greedy. You know, there is enough for everyone's need, but there isn't enough for everyone's greed. Human beings have just become so greedy. We do not, everyone wants to show that I can afford, say, 4 cars. You don't need to take 4 cars out and add to the vehicular pollution. We can kind of pool and drive together. We can cycle a bit. We can be kind to the plants because the plants also feel. We have just become so insensitive. We have just become so self-centered. And human beings, of course, are the main reason for all the destruction. With the industrial exploitation of the resources of the earth, and this has become especially bad since the population of the earth has tripled in the last 50 years to a point which even with more efficient means of distribution, there is simply not enough food to go around. There isn't enough food. Our population is growing. I mean, the kind, if you read the chapter, you'll see how, with, you know, it's almost like Palkhivala talks about that every second, there are about 4 people added to the earth, there are 4 children born, and today it must be more. With every second, there must be like many more children being born, and with advanced medicine, not so many dying, really. So the earth is really, really burdened. And earlier, they would perhaps deplete 1 acre of land. Now, every second, there are about many more acres of green belt being destroyed. So can you imagine more people, and more destruction? The earth is just so sick. It cannot take our inconsiderations. It cannot take our attacks anymore. And so now the Mother Earth, which has been like a mother to us, which has been guarding and taking care of us and feeding us, is in a very, very attacking mode. The seas and oceans are being poisoned by chemical products, oils, industrial and human waste. On land, especially in the industrial countries, where most waste is actually manufactured, there is increasingly little room to bury it. And even when buried, noxious elements leach out and destroy the health of the area. An even greater problem is disposable of atomic waste, unsafe to dump into the sea. It simply kills. We have so much of waste, we have industrialization, but we are not recycling the waste. We're just polluting the rivers with chemicals, the oceans, and we're just destroying all kind of life. We leave nothing for us to live on. And even more unsafe to bury under the land, an alternate possibility, that of sending it out into space, would perhaps create another more serious dangers, not immediately apparent to us. It will create many more serious dangers. So what do you do with waste? And what do you do with atomic waste is a huge question. We better start thinking on those grounds. The depletion of the principal biological systems. You have this image here. Students, have a look at it, and let's go on. The author mentions the ecological concern pointed out by Mr. Lester R. Brown in his book, The Golden Economic Prospect. Mr. Brown points out 4 principal biological system: fisheries, forests, grasslands, and croplands. These form the foundation of the global economic system as they supply food and provide raw materials. But we are happily attacking not only the forests, we are attacking the sea life, we are attacking the grasslands, the croplands. There is no place we do not want to construct. We just want to build and build concrete. We want to destroy, but we do not want to plant. We do not want to think that after us, what is going to happen to this beautiful earth? World's most dangerous animal. And Nani Palkhivala very beautifully says, talks about how his trip to Lusaka and where in a cage there is a placard which says that man's most the most lethal animal, and then you look, there is a mirror and you see your own reflection. And it is true that human beings are the most dangerous animals. Animals just don't attack. Animals take as much as they need. Animals provide their own food chain, and they're far more sensitive. But human beings are thoughtlessly attacking. We are killing each other. We are killing the environment. We are killing the sea life. We're just killing and killing. So there is no animal which is more dangerous than human beings. Very, very appropriately said. Human activity and their impacts. So let's look at this earth, how sad and dejected our earth looks. It's totally destroyed. The population growth is more and more. It's increasing. It's doubled, tripled. Environmental pollution has increased. Resources have depleted. Industrialization, we are just going on and on and creating more and more industries. Ozone depletion, ozone's layer has been depleted because of that poisonous UV rays are coming and attacking the vegetation, attacking us. We are responsible for creating this global warming because we just don't stop. We are just we are adding to the deforestation. We are adding to the vehicular pollution, the industrial pollution, land pollution, water pollution. We are not stopping, and hence global warming. Because of this global warming, now we have come to almost a stage which I shudder to think may be a stage where we have no return. A change in the human perception. So what is it that we can do? Nani Palkhivala is, of course, a highly literate man, and he had a perception, and he is warning us in this article and says that, you know, we need to change our perception. We cannot treat nature as an inanimate thing. We have to think of it as a living organism like ourselves. We have to think of it as something with its own fundamental rights. Students, I just can't come and cut your hand or cut your leg because I don't like you. You have your fundamental rights. Similarly, a tree, similarly the environment, we must respect that it too has its right to live, and right to live a healthy life, and right to have air around it, which is breathable. So we have to change a perception from that of a conqueror, the perception of that the world was made for our benefit. Now, we are not just two. The world was not just made for our benefit. Today, we are millions and millions. The world is not only for us in this generation, but the world is a gift of God for generations to come. So we need to have a revolutionary change of ideas. We need to respect the fact the environment must have its environmental rights. The environmental has to be rights have to be looked at it as a living organism with its fundamental rights, and we must look at ourselves not as owners of this earth but as trustees. What is the difference? An owner can do what he wants to, you know, a trustee cannot. You are responsible because this you are using, you are a tenant, you're using it, but it does not belong to you. It belongs to the beautiful generations which are going to come hundreds of years later. We must be more responsible. We have to change our attitude and realize that today we are trustees. We are not the owners. We are not the rulers of the earth. And if we refuse to change our stand, if we refuse to change our perception of the environment, it's not very late. We can still change our perception that, you know, we are heading for a huge disaster. A revolutionary change has come in the perception of human beings, bringing in a holistic and ecological view of the earth. So looking at the world, firstly, as a whole, let us not only think that, okay, I'm worried about my state, I'm worried about my country. Today, the world, you have to look as a whole. If the subcontinent is adding to environmental pollution, it's going to affect the world around. So we cannot say, it's our country, we will do what we want to. We must be more responsible and look at the world as a whole and not as broken parts. There has been a shift from understanding developed by Copernicus to the people's belief that the earth is a living organism whose needs must be respected and preserved by us. According to the writer, earth is like a patient in declining health. So we must accept the fact that it too is a living organism and it too has its fundamental rights. We have no business to tamper with its health. Our planet is in declining health and we need to rise up to this occasion and do something to get it back to good health. Thus, we have to realize our ethical responsibility of guarding the planet. New awareness shift from domination to partnership. We have to accept the fact that we're not in the cave age. We cannot dominate this earth anymore. We have to think of a relationship of partnership. Like good partners, if we are nice to the environment, if we are nice to our earth is going to be nice to us. If we think of plantations, if we think of saving the life, if we think of making our ailing planet more green, the planet is going to think of not attacking us with frequent floods and tsunamis and earthquakes. Need of the hour, sustainable development. The World Commission on Environment and Development propagated the concept of sustainable development in 1987. Sustainable development calls for a well-balanced and development so as to meet the demands of the present and not to deprive our future generations from the natural world of resources. So I've already spoken about it in the beginning, students, that the need of the hour is sustainable development. What do you understand from this concept? Sustainable development is nothing but use, but be conscious of the fact that other generations need to be sustained for. So you have to be a conscious citizen and use, if you do need wood, do use wood, but also be conscious of planting more trees. Otherwise, you have to maintain the balance. You cannot keep taking and not giving. You must find alternate sources. You don't have to keep attacking one kind of resources or alternate develop alternate food habits or grow your own food and not cut down on meat eating, perhaps, so that many species live and many species do not get extinct. The 7 hours of green technology. What are the 7 hours of green technology? Reduce, reliable, repair, reuse, recycle resources and replace. So let's remember this. Let's repeat it once more. Let's reduce what we need. Let's use things which are reliable. Let's be reliable. Let's repair and not keep throwing and adding to the waste and making new things. Let's learn to reuse, recycle, be very conscious of resources, and let's try to replace. If we do need certain resources, let's think how best can we replace those resources. Era of responsibility. The author mentions the holistic view of the basis of our existence. He points that it is an era of responsibility that calls for seeing the world as an integrated whole rather than a dissociated collection of parts. I've already mentioned that we cannot say that it's my country, I'll do what I want to. It is my will. It is no more my will, my country. You have to look as the world. The world is a global village today, and it is very quick to reach another part of the world. You cannot just keep doing things which is going to destroy, and we have to rise up above these borders and feel equally responsible for the world around. What we do wrong is going to affect a neighbor and vice versa. In conclusion, the chapter concludes with the beautiful lines of Mr. Lester Brown. We have not inherited this earth from our forefathers. We have borrowed it from our children. So what does he say? Very telling lines there. It says that we have not inherited, that we can do with it what we want to. Let us change our perception and believe that we have borrowed it from our little children. So we must be responsible. We must keep it healthy, sound, and flourishing for the generations to come. Our earth belongs as much to the future generation as much to us. We should soon realize our duty towards the planet and should not treat it solely as a property. So we should be very conscious and we should work towards making this world a better place. Let's quickly look at these words of vocabulary: sustainable development, a balanced development that meets the need of the present while taking care of the needs of the future generation. Language: lot of species are neglected or go unnoticed. There are thousands of species we're still not aware of. So how many we have destroyed, we are not aware of at all. These are just a few thousands or whatever, maybe a few lakhs of species we are aware of. Ignominious darkness: disgraced or dishonored as nobody has knowledge about them or is enlightened about them. So the lot of them died, they have come to this world and they have become extinct with all the things we have been doing, and we have never had the good fortune of knowing these species. Inter alia, amongst other things, and decimated, to reduce drastically in number. Catastrophic depletion, a disastrous and harmful depletion. Depletion is one thing, but catastrophe is totally destructive, hugely destructive. Harmful reduction in the number of something. Transcending concern, a concern that surpasses generations and boundaries. So if you look at the world as a whole, you do not look at it as broken parts, but you think of it as a living organism with a total whole, and we are all a part of it. We realize that our concern should be transcending our borders. Our concern should be for the world as a whole. It is not only about the present, but also about future, not only about the people, but also about the planet. As students, I hope we have been able to convey the important points and ideas and visuals to you regarding this chapter, which is a very important chapter, because unless we are aware, our generation is aware of how ailing our planet is, we are not going to rise up to this emergency. I hope you've enjoyed viewing it and listening to the lecture as much as we have enjoyed preparing it for you. Thank you for your attention.